Okay, so I think we're about to get started. If you don't mind for now, if everybody can turn their cameras off, I'm like a cat with a flashlight. I'm very easily distracted. So if you have a question, feel free to raise your hand. If you want to be on camera, that's fine. Otherwise, I'm going to be looking at people's home decor and stuff. Right. There's a few more people. Maybe let them in. So first, I want to make it clear what I'm going to be talking about mostly today. So what I'm going to be talking about mostly today is how I use the data that I put into Airtable to create the portal. I have done a full hour-long video already on Airtable itself. So that link is in the document link that I already sent you. So check that out first. I'm going to try to give like a brief 5 to 10 minute rundown of some of the data that I put into Airtable, so it won't be completely nonsensical to you if you haven't looked at that other Airtable video. But basically, what you need to know is the base is Airtable. That's pretty much your foundation. All your data is going to go into, it's going to go into Airtable, and then I'm using other systems to kind of manipulate and to show the data. So software is a portal that I have created that displays the data to the client. So that's what that is. So it's obviously not going to work if your underlying foundation Airtable doesn't have all the data that you need. So I'm going to briefly go through that again. Watch the whole hour-long Airtable video if you have more questions. It's probably still not going to answer all of your questions because you're going to have different needs. But there are tons of Airtable videos on YouTube. I had somebody on Fiverr, his name is Eric Samia, I believe is how you pronounce it. He helped me fine-tune some of the stuff that I was doing. And I put his link in that document also, so you can contact him to help kind of set things up. But I just kind of want to explain the sort of general overall high concept, which is Airtable is the base, that's your foundation. And then software is basically just like a window. And we're sort of looking through software into Airtable. They're looking at data that you kind of want them to see. So yes, Russell, software is a complete replacement to Clink. And I absolutely love Clink. So if people are using Clink, because I have recommended that to a whole bunch of people, there is nothing wrong with Clink as a portal. I'm just lazy. So, and I'm not billing by the hour either. So I need things to be as efficient as possible. So the only issue with software is with Clink is that it's manual. I am actually manually putting things into Clink. So I'm uploading documents there. We are chatting on Clink with the clients. It is wonderful as a client portal. I am just simply trying to eliminate that entire step of putting things into the portal. So this way, I'm putting documents into Google Drive on my end, and they're automatically going to each client's portal, and I don't have to do any other steps. So that is the main benefit of software. So I'll start with sharing my screen. And we're going to look at screen two. So I'm going to briefly go over, it's still loading. Okay, so I'm going to briefly go over two of the boards that are connected with software and just kind of briefly tell you what kind of data I'm putting into software so it can kind of give you some ideas, into Airtable, so it can give you some ideas of what to put on a client portal. So this is the status. This is a demo copy. I copied my actual dashboard, deleted all my clients' names, but you can see across here all of the different columns of data that I like to have in a case. So I've got the case name, the judge, the county, the type of case it is, where we are in the process, if they're planning for a defendant. I've got payment notes. Literally everything that I want to know about a case is here. Obviously, the way that this is laid out is not super attractive, but that's fine. So you can fix that within Airtable. You can look at it all a bunch of different ways. So you can see on the left, you can do a Kanban board, gallery, timeline, list, Gantt. I personally don't use any of those. What I use is an interface. So I actually had somebody build this for me. And it's going to have some deleted fields in there because the underlying data has been deleted, but you kind of get the idea. So up here is where all the clients' names would be had they not been deleted. But this is just a snapshot of every single thing that's happening in this client's case. We've got the name, we've got the kids, case links, their claims file, where the stage is, the date of service, all the information that I want to know about my case. So when I'm going to trial, this is something that I kind of print out to look at. And again, just more crap. And then here, I can't scroll all the way down because it has the names. Those are calendar events. So every single thing related to this file is in this interface. So that's why the input of the data is so important, because even if it looks crazy on, you know, the horizontal view, it, I think, looks pretty great this way. So let's go back to the data. So that's the status board. So with the time board, I'm going to move this over here. With the time board, what I'm using the time board for is automatic emails, entries to bill. Now, I don't bill because I'm flat fee, but I do like to keep track of my time. So every single email that comes in, just like in most firms, you would bill it as a 0.1 at least. So every single email that comes in, I have a, I don't know if it's Zapier or Zapier, whatever. I have a Zap set up to grab all of my emails and put them into this board. And I found it's a lot easier to delete and then add. So it adds all of my emails, and I just have to go through once a day and delete all the ones that are not related to the case. And then I add the case name to it in this section here that says case name lookup. So that's what I use the time board for. From there, what you can do is on the extension, you can create an invoice based on this board. I don't do that because, again, I don't bill and I don't invoice. I just send a link and say, hey, you owe $1,500 for this stage of the case. But you can create invoices. So Lauren, oh gosh, I forget her last name, Nelson, Wilson, something. She's the one that kind of opened my eyes to what Airtable could do. So I use a page designer, but I just use it differently. I have a kind of short one-page summary of everything. And you can see down here, it's 48 pages. So for all 48 pages of my case, my cases, this would have all of the data for the cases that I am handling. So obviously it's blank because I've deleted all the information out of it, but that's one way that you can use Page Designer. But you can do invoices, you can do a ton of stuff with the extensions board. So tasks is pretty self-explanatory. What I do like about this, it's pretty customizable. I'm on the view of, this is my paralegal's task list. So she just assigns things to me when they're done. This is status. You can see I've got a gazillion statuses. So it's obviously very customizable. And the priority and when it's last modified by. This is the payments board. So this, again, I'm flat fee. So that just, it tracks all of the payments. And then I'll show you how it all comes together in the interface as well. So all of these tabs are just different things that I'm using to try to track data in my firm. These are clients that owe money. These are FedEx boxes that need to go out. This is, and we'll skip to the calendar. So I've deleted again the names of the clients, but this syncs directly with my Google Calendar. I've always used Google Calendar for all of my firm events. I got tired of trying to make it sync with the million different practice management systems I was using. So I just started with Google Calendar and I've kept it going. Thankfully, it integrates seamlessly with Airtable. So anytime you add an event to Google Calendar, it's going to add up here. And I could put it on calendar view. You can put it on Kanban view. You can sort, filter, all kinds of things to get the data to look exactly the way you want to look. For our purposes, though, I am just showing you this because in order for it to view on the portal, they're only the client's calendar events. I had to kind of come up with a workaround where I kind of give it a name. And then I can filter each client's portal so they can only see the events that have that particular name associated with it. So that is what I'm doing with that. See, this is my leave of absence. These are all the dates that I'm going to be out coming up. And the good thing about this is I can just put it here and it's going to multiple places. So one thing Airtable does let you do is embed anything. So you can embed this view very easily. You just click embed this view and you just copy and paste the HTML code to your website or to whatever it is that you want. In my case, it's on my my Canva client guide. It's in my fee agreements. So my fee agreements automatically update with my leave of absence. It's everywhere. So this is just where I edit it and then it's just disseminated everywhere and updates instantly, obviously. So that's just kind of an overview of the data I'm putting in that it has to do with the firm. So the interfaces that I use, I showed you the client board. This is the case info. This helps me get really granular with the data that I want in terms of where are most of my cases. You can see 46% of my cases, current cases, are in Gwinnett, which is great because that's where my office is and I don't like to drive. So I'm trying to actually get that up to 60%. So this kind of helps me track that. This talks about what kinds of cases that I'm doing. Divorce with children are like the soul sucking cases ever, but unfortunately it's 40% of my income right now. So I'm gonna keep doing it. So case open in days, I like to track how long my cases are open, what stages each case is in, and how many cases are open per month. I also have a closed case interface. This shows cases that I've closed, what counties they're in, their type. And then I also like to track monthly how many cases I'm opening per month and how many cases I'm closing per month. So these are very easy to set up in terms of just adding these graphs and widgets. The one I did have help with was the money one. So this is not just last year. Don't get excited. That number covers more than 1 year. So I use Profit First. So I had Eric, who helped me set up Airtable. He's done the percentages for each category that I do. I'm going to change this actually to 2024. Numbers going to go way down. So this is how much money I made in 2024. But I can get into data in terms of this is how much per month. I've got average monthly income. This is for 2023. I'll probably update this to do 2024 because my goal is to hit 50,000 a month. As you can see, that like happened four times. So obviously need to work on that. And then I also like to get into what kinds of cases are bringing me the most money. So I can just easily go up here and, for example, divorce with kids. Well, nothing for this year, but I'll do 2023. So I can know instantly which kind of cases are bringing in money. And I'll go to one, which I'm sure is not a lot, contempt. Yeah, so that's not really a big money maker. So I actually might take those out of my offerings altogether. So that's just a way for you to view data within Airtable. And of course, you can share any data with your clients. I would assume that you wouldn't want to share this kind of data with them. I'm just trying to give you an overview of the kind of stuff that Airtable can do, which is why I was super excited about Airtable before we even got to the whole portal thing. So then now I'm going to show you the template case plan. So this is what 99% of the data that's going to be feeding into the portal that I'm showing to the client. So first I'll start with the client update. This is pretty self-explanatory. This has an explanation of where we are in the case. I did forget to mention that in Airtable, you can adjust the row heights. So you can go from very short to very tall. So for this particular one, I'm using the tall format. It automatically updates with the last modified. This is a multi-choice selection. So you can see I can delete and add more stuff. And then you also see here the last modified automatically updated. So this is what I use to update the client. So I just post my update here in Airtable, and then it's going to get disseminated to the client portal. So I'll actually show you the portal. Yes. Okay, so this is a preview of what the actual portal looks like. It's gonna come up in a second. And I'm gonna preview it as a logged in user. So this is what the main page looks like. This, of course, is just kind of an overview of how to navigate the portal. As you can see, I put my leave of absence in here. And the status, which we were just looking at in Airtable, that's going to be here on this board. So this is the status that comes from Airtable to tell the client what the status of their case is. This is an explanation of everything. And then I did this little Canva chart, which I'm unreasonably proud of, which is kind of like a timeline of where everybody is in the case. So when people say, what's next, what's next, what's next, I kind of refer them to this page because we do say, this is what we're doing now. This is what's coming up. this is the status, and you can see the full timeline of the case all on one page. So I just, at this point, I'm just referring them back to the portal because it's going to have all the information that they need. So going back to Airtable, we talked about the client update page. So the contact info page, this obviously has my firm member's information here, but once I copy this template and then start using it for each individual client, then this is where I add the client's name, email, and phone, because Softr is going to grab that information from this particular tab. And it will, that's what tells Softr that only the people that are on this spreadsheet can log in and view the portal, because the portal is just a website. So anybody can just click on the link and go to the website. They just won't be able to see anything unless they are one of these users in this table. So that's fairly simple. Onboarding, so what I did is, if you haven't seen my video on my case plan documents, you can go and look at that. That's also fairly lengthy. But what I did is, I'm basically a huge checklist person. I love checklists. So I ended up taking those checklists and I imported them into Airtable, which was not hard to do because it's just an Excel spreadsheet and you can import CSV, Excel, anything into here. So this is essentially that case plan document. If you have that and you purchase that for me, that's essentially what this is. So you can see these are my tasks that I have to do to onboard. I did a new checklist called Issues and Evidence Needed, and I have it sorted by which category. Obviously, each case is different. This is my base template. Something unusual is going to come up. Like if, I don't know, dad's a drunk and we need evidence of dad being a drunk, then I'm just going to add a line here that says evidence of dad being an alcoholic, and I'll put in the notes the evidence that we need to gather. So I do this initially when I'm starting out the case because it helps my staff create the correct discovery questions. And it helps me when I'm reviewing discovery responses and talking to my client to make sure that we're honing in on the stuff that really matters. Like if they only have 3 cents and, you know, not a pot to piss in, you know, I'm not gonna do 8 rounds of discovery asking for all of that. So I really use this to kind of focus in on what we really need to get the case resolved and or try. So I'm going to skip over the next four and go back to them. So this is the discovery. So FM is going to mean nothing to most of you, which is Fulton Mandatory Discovery. In that particular county, we have mandatory discovery that the county puts out, and then we have to do supplemental. So it kind of sucks because I had four discovery stuff things to do instead of two. So when I use this as a template, and if it's not in Fulton County, then I just delete it. So that's what this is. And one thing I really love about Softr is it will filter on the portal based on any filter you want. So I just created a column set of, do I want this available to the client? And if it's checked, it's going to show up on the portal. So I will go to that page, which is discovery. And so there shouldn't be that many columns because I don't have that many checked. Right, so there's only two. So I found this is sort of easier this way, so I'm not overwhelming the client with everything at once. So for example, if we're just kind of dealing with, let's say we're dealing with the outgoing Fulton mandatory discovery. And so all I want them to do is focus on that. I will just put the things that they really need to focus on. What's the status of the responses? When were the requests sent? This is when we received them. And then here's a link. I just use ESPN for now, but here's a link. So the client can actually click on the link and view the other side's documents. So again, I do love the Clinked portal, but if I'm using the Clinked portal, what I would have to do is upload all these documents to the portal separately and either upload the documents within the portal so they can look at them, or I have to add a link to the Clinked portal and then they can look at it all at once. So it's just an extra step. And over time, honestly, it just kind of builds up. So then we'll go back to the discovery page and refresh, and it should show the additional columns that I added. You can also add these filters. So if you only want to look at outgoing bulk mandatory discovery, for example, then the client can click and just focus on those. Those are the only things that I found work. It has a search button. I don't think it works. I don't think it's meant to search within embedded tables. So I am going to be deleting that because I actually don't think it works. So a workaround is if you're looking for something specific, this is just a website. So you can just control F and use your browser's find and search function to search what you're looking for. So that's something that was brought to my attention by my guinea pig slash clients who agreed to kind of, you know, audit my system for me. All right, so going back to the template, and again, this is the template that every client has. So when you see this little Google Drive linked, it's a synced table. That means it's synced with Google Drive. And what you have to do, and it took me entirely too long to figure this out, is create a template and have this point to a dummy or a sample file. And the reason why is you can't add it later. So what you can do is after you have this template, so when you're duplicating it, you would just go here and you duplicate the base. And then when you need to change what it points to, you can just change the source. So that's the easiest way to kind of have the template and then change what it's pointing to without having to start from scratch. And it, like I said, it took me entirely too long to figure that out. So we'll do start with correspondence. So I'm going to drag over here. This is my Windows folder. And this is the dummy file that I have for this demo. And you can see the correspondence is matched with this correspondence folder. So everything that's in here is going to show up on here immediately and instantly. So if I add, it's going to add a document. Blah, blah. So once I've added a document, and I'm just using this in Windows, but obviously if you're using Google Drive online, you can just add it there too. It's the same thing. So this will automatically sync, I want to say maybe every 5 minutes or so, but you can also force a sync. And then obviously you can see it's been added here as well. So the benefit of this is I'm not doing any extra work on my end. Once I draft the correspondence, it's already in the Airtable and it's already pushed to, actually, I'm gonna add that back. It's already pushed to the client's portal. So I will go to the correspondence on their portal so you can see what that looks like. And another thing I really like too is you can add notes. So obviously sometimes when you're uploading things, your client's like, hey, what is this? I don't know what this is. So this is what their portal looks like. So they see the name of the document, when it was uploaded. Actually, you change that to upload date. They can click to look at the file, and then there will be notes here. One thing I do want to mention is my Google Drive is locked down, which means only my staff can see the whole of Google Drive. So in order for your client to see the documents you want them to see, you have to give them access to those particular folders. So in this, you know, dummy folder that we have here, then I would give client access to this folder. I would give client access to this folder, which contains just the pleadings that I want them to see, and the drafts, and I call drafts for client approval. So those specific folders you have to give the client access to, otherwise they can click on the link, it'll just tell them that they don't have access to it. So I also have notifications and automations on here. So I add a note to the client, they will get an email. So anytime anything is added to Google Drive, that means it's added to Airtable, which means it's also posted to portal and it sends an email. So all of that happens just by you saving a file to a particular folder. So as you can see, there's a note here. It's going to show up on their portal. And the automation is going to send them a note saying, hey, you have an additional note on this document. So I'll show you what the automation looks like. The automations are actually pretty simple to set up. It's two steps. So when a record is updated, this is for drafts. This is going to send me a message. So I'll show you the drafts in a second. But for correspondence, when a record is created, then an email is sent. I have this because this is a dummy file to me and Krista, but this would be the client's email here. And I think I can do a preview. Yes, this is a preview of what the email looks like. So they're going to get an email that says, hey, you have a new letter. This is the name of the letter. They can click to look on the document. If there are any notes, they'll be here. And I also have a link to their full correspondence folder. They just want to look at the whole folder at once. So again, this is all automatically done. I don't do anything. All I have to do is create the file and put it where I was going to put it anyway. So it cuts out like four steps at least. So in terms of syncing the file to Google Drive, these all work the same way. You just have to go and point it to the right place. So with drafts, I'm going to delete this. So in drafts, what I've done is Softr allows you to have the client update records, which is fantastic. So this is we're pretending that we are the client looking at this document. So I have given this to the client to look at and say, hey, here's the parenting plan. Are you okay with it? All they have to do is click here to add notes, and it's going to update the record. And I want to meet at the gas station. So they put literally whatever they want to in here and hit update. And of course, once they've done that, it will have updated here in Airtable, and it's going to send an email to me and my office manager saying, hey, the client looked at this document and here are the client's notes on the document. So that is super helpful. So as a portal, what I was doing is uploading documents, putting a note in there, and just waiting for them to respond. And of course, I would get the email saying that there was a response. But what this cuts out is I don't have to post anything extra. So I don't have to proactively go into Claims, log in, find the client's portal, find the folder of the client's portal, and then upload the document and add a note. I don't do any of that now because everything is automatically synced to Google Drive. So pleadings works pretty much the same way. Again, these are just notes that I have. Oh, hurry up. On each document, if they are on a phone, they're not going to see this whole horizontal thing. So they're just going to have to scroll. And there's going to be a scroll bottom here, scroll line at the bottom where they need to scroll right to see everything. What else? I'll show you. This is the client guide. So I have a link to my client guide, and they can also view it as a video if they want to. I need to look like her again. I don't know who she is, but I want to look like her again. Anyway, so this is my client guide, and they can play it kind of as a movie, or they can actually click on the link. So in terms of softer, it's unlimited in how many pages you want to put on here. So I'm trying to keep it to about 10 pages of the things that are most important to my clients, which are the status, the letters that go in and out, pleadings, drafts, discovery, calendar, and then upload files. So I use an external system to upload files, which is, I'm trying to remember the name of it and I can't right now. Easy File Drop? I don't remember. But on software, you can embed any kind of code and it's very easy. So whatever system that you're using to retrieve files, you don't have to change it. All you have to do is add a box with custom code and then find your embed HTML code and just slap it on there. And there it is. So it looks like they're uploaded to the portal, but they're still using a separate system. So this has been pretty helpful because I do use multiple systems. And I kind of felt bad about asking clients to use different systems. Like, hey, you have a portal, but I don't want you to upload things. I want you to use another link. And then we use Pipefile to get discovery. So the good thing about this is it's kind of the home base. So even though they're using other systems, they don't really know it because it's all embedded in here. So on the discovery page, for example, I use Pipefile to get documents. And if you don't know what that is and you haven't seen that video, that's also on the YouTube channel. It'll change your life. So I can actually include the link here for Pipefile. So anytime I'm requesting documents from a client using Pipefile, they get their own secure link. So then I just would add it here in the section that says, here's your Pipefile link. And that is, where is that? Where's discovery? So I don't have that visible, but you can see here in the template, Pipefile link to post your responses. So they would have that link available. So again, they're just starting with the portal, but they don't have to remember the names of all of these different systems that I have. It's all kind of embedded in their portal. Let me look at my notes, see if I missed anything. The calendar has been the most finicky. So this is the calendar and hopefully it has stuff on it. We're about to find out. So what you're supposed to be able to do is filter each client's calendar events by their logged in name. I have never gotten that to work. So what I do is I just create a second name for it, and then I just filter it by that. So any document, any calendar event that has that particular name will show up just for this client. I think this has all the events on it, which is why it's taking 8 million years to load. Let's see. So this is the softer building module. And as you can see, you can add as many pages as you want. You can put whatever you want. One thing that I've not put live is a video library because I'm still sort of getting it together. So what this is going to be is a link to all of the videos that are going to be relevant for the client's case, like how to fill out a financial affidavit. So I have all of the videos. I just need to put them into the Airtable board, and then it would get synced here, but I just haven't done that yet. So this is a great way to actually make this portal a knowledge base also. And then you don't have to update each portal. Anytime your video library that's in Airtable is updated, everybody's portal is going to see the same information. So I think that's pretty cool. Okay, fine. We're finally done with this. Okay, so I will show you what it looks like when it's filtered. So this calendar is set to my dashboard and not to the individual client's folder. And this doesn't have any filters on it, but I can add a filter that says when the softer short name is, and I think sample I use says sample, then it should only show the event that has that name, and it's only one. So hopefully that won't take too long. I've been completely ignoring the chat, guys. I need to go back to it. Well, because it's going to take a second to load anyway. Okay, let me go back to the beginning. Does your calendar designate your calendar separate from your staff? My Google Calendar does. So this particular calendar that I'm syncing with Airtable is, I call it EFL, which is my work calendar. So my staff has access to my personal calendar and my work calendar, so they don't schedule work stuff when I'm, you know, getting a blowout or something. So they can see it all, but they can see it on Google Drive. But I've only synced. And that's another great thing about Airtable is I can sync just particular calendars to it. How do you check the tasks as completed? Okay, so that's in Airtable and that's in the case plan. No, it's in this. So there's a done tab. So that's here. It says closed. So when I'm done with it, I hit closed. And that actually, an automation is set up for that as well. So anytime a task is actually closed, it goes into the time for, it'll build for it. So that's pretty simple. All right, Keisha asks, oh yeah, she answered the question. Will this work linking to Dropbox? I don't think Airtable has a native integration with Dropbox. So that's why I completely switched to Google Workspace just because of Airtable. So before that, I was using Ignite as my sole kind of cloud repository, and Ignite is great. It's fantastic. It's just not a native sync with Airtable. And as you can see, it makes things a lot easier. When you can have that integrated native sync with Airtable, just it cuts out like a million steps. I think I saw somewhere that Airtable and Dropbox were going to add it. I could be completely lying. The other thing you should know is they're both super zappable. So it's possible you can do something similar with Zapier. I don't know how to do that. I didn't want to figure out how to do it. I was totally fine using Google Drive and Google Workspace. So that's what I did. Flink has a robust chat feature. That is a great question, Matthew. They do not have a native chat feature, but the email that I use is called front.com and they have a chat widget. So you can install your chat widget. So let's refresh this. Okay, so this is the calendar that has now been filtered, and this is the only event that I coded as sample. So this is that event. So whatever you put in the Airtable is going to come up on here. So if it's if there's a Zoom link, it's going to be here. This is the link to the actual calendar. I am not sure if they click on this link, if they're able to download the calendar event, but I'm fairly certain they are because it's just a Google Calendar event. So I think that they can. So as you can see on this page, there's this little button down here. That's just a widget. So this just happens to be a front.com widget, which is what I use, but you can sign up with any live chat service you want to. They all have widgets. They all have embed codes. And then all you have to do is take that code and then put it into each page of your portal. And I'll show you where I did that. It was stupid easy. All right, here is the homepage. And it's going to look blank because there's nothing really there, but this is where that code was added. No, it's not a line. It's either below or above this. Let's see, there it is. Okay. So if you can see that over on the right side, this is the widget. So all I did was take the HTML code for the chat widget and add a custom code block. That's just what they call it. And you just cut and paste, and then your chat will show up on each page. Why use POP file and not have them upload discovery docs to Softr? So pipe file is just way more robust. So yes, I could send them discovery requests and say, hey, upload all your crap, but I'm going to get a whole mess. So what pipe file does, and again, there's a whole webinar on pipe file. So, but I'm going to log in real quickly to show you why it's so different. You can separate it out per request, and it just makes it a million times easier. So this is a current case that I have, and I'm actually firing this client because he absolutely refuses to give me the stuff that I need. But as you can see, all of these are separate sort of entries, and the client uploads the document into each particular folder. So it cannot possibly be made any easier, as opposed to just saying, you know, upload them all. So that means, ideally, if I have a line that says credit card statements, they are only uploading credit card statements into that particular section. And it's drag and drop. So it's very easy for the client. And I can see when they viewed it. These are instructions. And you can see here, this is the stuff that he has uploaded. So you can download it all at once. This actually does have a native sync with Dropbox and something else. Yeah, Google Drive, Dropbox, or a zip file. So you can export everything at once. But when the client gets the original set of instructions, then it's kind of like a questionnaire. And for each question, they're uploading documents into that particular folder. So the answer to the question is you're going to get organized. You're going to get organized responses as opposed to just like a cluster F of documents that you then further have to go through and then organize. So I absolutely love PyFile. It's been a godsend. Do you send documents, docs back and forth through the portal? Short answer is no, you can. I just saw that Softr included that as a feature. I personally don't use that right now. So I have Lawmatics as my CRM. So most of the documents I need signed, I either send with Lawmatics or I use HelloSign. It's not a big enough need that I feel like I needed to do that in Softr, but I could if I wanted to. Let me see if I have any more notes. So in terms, I'm going to stop sharing my screen for a minute. I found out recently that there's a ton of systems that do this now. I think some of them are new because they're kind of jumping on the bandwagon of seeing how easy it is to build a no-code website. So I've included that in the link that I sent. There's Stacker, there's Table to Site, Quori.io. So there's a bunch of different systems that you can use to kind of create a portal for the client. You also don't have to use any of it because Airtable allows for embedding. So you could honestly just take the embedded table and just put it literally wherever you want it to. So you don't have to use Softr. I just think it's just very, very easy to use and it's not expensive. I want to say it is, you know, don't get me to lie. There's a pricing plan. Okay, here it is. I believe I'm on professional. Nope, I'm not. I think I'm on basic, which is $50 a month. So you can start for free if you want to. And that's what I did. I built everything for free and it works exactly the same. It's just, you obviously get a very limited amount of how many users you can have. So yeah, I'm on the basic, which is $50 a month. So to me, that's not cost prohibitive enough where I want to just create my own website from scratch. Because honestly, that's a little bit above my pay grade. Does anybody have any questions so far? I know it seems like a lot and it kind of is. I heard about Softr, I want to say maybe September. Dan is the one that mentioned it to me and I started playing with it then. And I just kind of gradually just started updating the dummy portal over the last few months, and I took some time over the holidays to kind of finish it out. Matthew is asking, is there any functionality that you miss from Clink that you can't replicate in Softr? So my guinea pig slash client came up with two things that she had a really good point. So on the pleadings module, I can't, or she can't sort. So sharing screen again. So I picked the sort. So I've sorted this by the name from Z to A. And because I have the date first, then it's going to have the newest file first and go backwards. That's the sort that I have on it. You can't have the client really put any sort of other sort on top of it. But what you can do is add filters for the client to use. And let's see if I can do that pretty quickly. It's not hard. So that was a suggestion that she gave me that was really helpful. And I'm also letting her know too that, because she's missing the search function that I had in Clink. So because everything is on Google Drive and they have access to Google Drive anyway, all they really have to do is click the Google Drive link and they can go directly to Google Drive, which is super searchable. So that's another workaround. It's not my favorite. I wish the search button worked, but it did not. And why is it taking so long? Okay. Okay, so this is the table and it's not getting the records. Second. Let's get correspondence. The thing decided to slow down immediately, of course. Something weird happened. Oh, that's nice. Great timing. Okay, so on the content page, you can add a filter. Oh, now it's catching up. Okay. On the content page, you can add a filter for the clients to use. So for example, here I can filter it by, I don't know what I'd be filtering it by, notes maybe. For pleadings, I would filter it by who filed it, the plaintiff filed it, defendant filed, or it's a court order. I think that's a very helpful filter. That's kind of the best I can do in terms of sorting it. So that's not ideal. I don't really think that there's a workaround for that. But that's one of the features that doesn't really carry over from Clink. It's not enough to make me want to do all of the other things that I have to do with Clink. And I love it, but because we have so many cases and so many documents coming in, the amount of time that we spend putting those documents on Clink is problematic. Okay, let me stop sharing my screen. Does anybody else have any other questions? Let's see, chat. Are you still using Ignite or Google Drive? I'm definitely using Google Drive because Google Drive is integrating with all of this. So one thing you do need to know about Google Drive, and I found this out entirely too late, is that there is a limit on your shared folder. It's 400,000 files. So you cannot have more than 400,000 files in a Google Share Drive or it will stop working. You will think you have created a document or added a document to your shared drive and Google Drive is like, nope, we're good. So what I've done is on Google Drive only, all I have is my current cases and that's it. So all of my initials, client consultations, that's still on Ignite. Basically everything except current files, I've kept on Ignite because there is no limit and there is a limit for some reason on Google Drive. Why Google Drive and not Box? Does Box integrate? I've never really used Box. I don't have anything against Box, but I was already using Google Workspace for my email anyway, and I use Google Calendar. So it just made sense to just use the Google Drive. What are the best resources for learning more? So I did put the link in the chat earlier and I'll post it again that has notes from all the different links that I use. I used a guy from Fiverr named Eric, I think he's in the Philippines, to help me build out the parts of Airtable that I couldn't figure out myself. So it is really easy to find people that are good at Airtable on Fiverr. Softer is new. So I only found one girl and she wasn't that great. She helped me fix like one thing. And then after that, she just wasn't really an expert on it, which to be fair, Softer is kind of new. So doesn't really surprise me. Where's my chat button? Oh, there it is. So I'm going to post the link again, and that's going to have all the information. So what are the costs for the entire tech stack? I have not added it up, to be perfectly honest. So with Airtable, I am on the team plan, which they're about to change because they realized they were undercharging. I was paying $20 a month, and I paid upfront yearly. So whatever 20 times 12 is, that is what I'm paying yearly for Airtable. I believe it's going to go up slightly in the near future. So that's for Airtable. And Softer, I am on the professional plan, which is $139 a month. So those two combined. But that actually includes all of my users. So I'm not paying per user. So the $139 plan includes 50 internal users and 5,000 external users. So the good thing about using non-law specific practice management systems is they tend to allow more flexibility. So like Clio, in my case, they're going to charge you per user, and those costs are really going to stack up. So with Softer and Airtable, you can have a bunch of users internally, you can have a bunch of external users, and your price is not going to go up significantly. So Beverly asked, does this completely replace Clinked? And the answer is yes for me, that it does. So the clients that I have on Clinked right now who really like it and their case is about to end, I'm just keeping them there because they like it. For all my new clients, I'm putting them on Softer because the amount of time that we save not having to upload documents separately is just kind of priceless. So Sherry, this is going to be recorded and it'll be on the YouTube channel. So I'll post the YouTube channel link. But if you subscribe to it, and I think people think that means they pay, it doesn't, it's free. So you can subscribe to the channel and you will get a notification of anytime I post a video. So there is the link. And I'm mystified by this because there's 12,000 people in the Facebook group and there's only 887 subscribers, and people always ask me, where's the video? I promise you, every video that I ever talked about or ever have done is on this channel. So if you'll subscribe, you will get a notification the second that I post a new video. Anybody else have any other questions? I'm gonna look around and see if there's anything I forgot to highlight.
Hey, Regina, it's Keisha.
Hey.
Hey, this is off topic. The documents that you had on Etsy, I had purchased it and then you made some edits. Oh, how do we go back and get the updated version of
email me? I'm gonna put my email in the chat because I will forget immediately when we get off the phone. So just email me and I'll send you the new one.
Okay, great. Thank you. Mm-hmm.
So what she's talking about is I did a case plan document for family law. And I did it on Google Sheets and I also did it on Excel. So what I did is really just sort of put that into Airtable, since Airtable is just a glorified spreadsheet anyway. So it's the same concept. I've just applied tech to all of my checklists. So there's also a video for that, I believe, that's on the YouTube channel that explains how I did the case plan documents. And honestly, you could watch the video on my case plan documents and just straight copy it if you wanted to. If you want to, knock yourself out. I don't charge a lot of money for it. So I think, you know, most people have found I'd rather just take the template and edit versus starting from scratch. But it is entirely possible to look at my video and look at the checklist and what I'm doing and then just do it yourself if you want to. I have zero problem with that. It just took me a lot of time. And I'm the kind of person, if I had seen a template, I would have paid for a template and edited it versus starting from scratch. It would pay me behind. Does anybody else have any other questions? All right, well, thanks for joining me. If you think of any things later, and I believe I posted the link to the demo, anything that you see doesn't work or things that you think that I should add to the portal, let me know. I'm totally open for suggestions. Sherry, can I repost what, which thing? The link to the demo, which demo? I'm not sure which demo you're referring to, but I will post the link that has a whole bunch of links in them about different things that I use. And I will add pipe file, which I discussed on here also. Oop, that's the wrong thing. Hold on. Okay. It's not letting me do that. So I need to go here and get it. Okay, so that's the Google Doc link. So that'll have a lot of the links in it. I'm going to add pipe file as well. But you can always post in the group if you have any questions or anything about any of the stuff that I'm using, because I know it's a lot and it sounds like a lot. But the benefit of this these kind of systems is once it's up and running, it works like clockwork. I've been using Airtable for about a year, and that has just gone so smoothly. And I'm just adding a layer on top of it, which is the portal to show the client. So that's probably going to have some kinks going forward. But, you know, that's fine. As long as it results in less work for me, I'm totally okay with that. So Candace is asking, what is the learning curve of Airtable compared to Monday? Like zero. So I exported all of my Monday sheets into CSV and I imported them into Airtable and I was up and running within 20 minutes. I mean, that's why I like Monday and Asana and Trello and those kinds of things, because everything is exportable in a format that you can easily put into anything else. So Beverly, it took me 20 minutes to get all of my different boards, because I had something like 65 boards in Monday. So the reason I changed from Monday to Airtable is because Monday, you kind of had to have a board for each thing, and Airtable allowed you to have different sections with different things. So you could see on Airtable where I have tabs. Monday doesn't allow that. So I do keep track of Monday, and I keep, I'm just going to share my screen again so you can see what I'm talking about. So this is my dashboard. So in Monday, this was 13 different boards. So this status board was a board, time was a board, task was a board. They're all different boards with different links that I'd have to navigate to enter data. And this is laid out more like Excel, where you can have different tabs. So that was the main reason I switched from Monday to Airtable. And it wasn't until after I started using Airtable when I realized all of the other capabilities that it had. So Monday does have the ability to visualize data. That stayed the same, but this tab option was not available in Monday. I haven't looked at Monday in a few months. I would not be shocked if they've added it, because I know a lot of people have mentioned that this is something that they wanted. How is Airtable broken down? Do you separate bases that link together? Do you have one base with tabs for each board? Both. So this is a copy of all of the cases that I have in my firm. And if they're closed, and I just hit close and they fall out of view. So this is just the layout that tracks every single thing related to how I'm running my practice. This is the status of the cases, this is the time, these are the tasks that we're doing, these are the payments. So all of these are in one board. I just have to click on different tabs. So that's one thing. And then the second thing I'm doing is these individual case plans for each client. So each client has their own case plan that looks like this. But again, these are all tabs within the same document. And when I was using Monday, again, I'd have like 20 different boards for one client, which makes zero sense. Do you have a spot for case notes in Airtable, or do they do that elsewhere? Yes, that's here, Candace. So if you look at issues, evidence needed, a lot of my case notes are going to be in here. When a client calls and says, hey, he's never on time, I'm going to add husband never on time. And I'm going to add notes and then links to the email or to the document or whatever that kind of points me in that direction. So there's a bunch of different places where you can include that information. I include it here on issues and evidence needed. when I'm going through my mediation and trial prep, I didn't really go through it here in this demo because it's not a full Airtable demo, but a lot of times that's where that information is going to go here in the notes section for each thing. So in terms of being a running tab of all the things that I ever do in a case, that's probably mostly going to be kept in the main section under time. So I did talk about how the emails automatically get put in here, but when someone's doing a task, they just add the task here. I don't do that a lot because honestly, everything that I do is automatically tracked. If I receive a document in the upload section, which again, I talk about in my Airtable video, it's going to bill for I received and reviewed this document. Does each of your client bases sync with your main firm base? And the answer is yes, in a way. So you can create an interface that pulls in data from whatever base, as long as it's in the same workspace. I don't find that much of a need to do it. The closest I get to it is this, whatever you call it, I don't even know what to call it. I used Page Designer to come up with a snapshot of each case. So you can see here, there's 48 cases. I've taken the most of the data out, but you can see it's populating data. It's not gonna have the client's names on here. But that's one way to kind of have all of the data for all of my clients kind of visible at once. So it's all, you know, interconnected. I would say my knowledge level on that is not great. So I would recommend contacting Eric, who is an Airtable expert, and basically just tell him in plain English, this is what I want it to do. And he'll tell you if it's possible or not, and then can do it. So I have kind of scratched the surface of what Airtable can do. I'm sure that it can do more, but for right now, this is kind of giving me what I need. Anita's asking, can you lock the information to ensure or to lock against accidental overwriting? I think you mean. I could, I don't, because you can undo anything. So if you look up here, this is the base history and you can click on it and you can undo all kinds of crap. And then you can find the snapshot and you have a year of snapshot history and then a record revision history. So I can go into expanded records and I can see who modified what. And then just kind of as a general tool, I think I use it more in the task section than anything else. There is a column to say when the column was last modified by. So every single line here, I could do an audit. So if I assign someone a task and like they just delete it, like don't do the task, doesn't happen, but I would know. So the answer to your question is, yeah, you can get a lot of data and you can see everything that's happening within Airtable. You can also have it email you a summary at the end of the day of all the crap that has happened. I do have a Slack notification, I think, on here for when my tasks are updated. And it's coded as super important, then it will send me a Slack message that basically lets me know I need to log on to Airtable and do the task. Do you have a payment system like LawPay integrated, or do you track payments with another tool? So I use Gravity. So you may have missed this earlier, but what I use is in this system is I just have a payment board. So we just include all the payments here. And I include the method, what it's for, what kind of case, because that helps me get, you know, real on my data in terms of how much money I'm making like from each kind of case. And then it's viewable in the interface where I can see you know, different data. So it's not integrated, so to speak. And honestly, I don't need it to be. I just send them a link. In my portal, I have a link for them to pay also. So the thing about the portal is even though I'm using probably 5 different systems, they don't really know that because they're just going to the portal and all the links are there. If they want to upload a file, they don't know they're using a different system. They're just clicking on the link that says upload a file. So I don't really try to integrate my payment system with anything else because I don't need to because I'm not tracking time. So I just send them the link to Gravity, they pay. And then on a weekly basis, my paralegal goes through and adds the data to this board. Okay, well, thanks everyone for showing up. If you think of questions later, if you're playing with the demo or anything, you're like, ooh, I really feel like I need something, definitely let me know. Candace saying, I use Clio for invoicing and payments. Could it integrate with the softer portal? The short answer is yes. How to do it would be a little more difficult. You can't submit your email to the demo site because you would have to be in my Airtable as a user in order to look at it. But you can view anything there. I've created it so you can view all of the different pages, but you're not going to be logged in. So the only thing that you would need to be logged in to see is the calendar. And I can't really fix that because it would take too long to give someone fake access and to filter out all of my client information. Well, thank you guys for coming. Let me know, like I said, let me know if you have any questions or you think of something I could have done differently or better or like literally anything. Nita, do you have a question? You're on mute, by the way. You're on mute.